Well, thank you so much for coming.
I'm hanging out with the greatness over here. I'm just amongst greatness. I'm the appropriate
what the associate judge, and then we have our chief judge, who I'm not sure, but what they spoke as we counsel up over the judges in the state.
I told her about when we went to Savannah.
And I was there, and I said they were really good. Yeah, they did. Tell what you stated.
We talked about prior mistakes.
Good morning, everyone.
Morning.
Morning. Thank you. My name is Jonathan Peters, and I'm the chair of the Department of Journalism at the University of Georgia. I also teach and research media law there, and I'm the president of the Georgia First Amendment Foundation, which for the fourth year has helped to organize this event. I'd like to welcome you all to the 33rd Bar, Media, and Judiciary Conference. It was originally conceived by judges and journalists as a way to get real conversations going between them and with lawyers at a time when they didn't always see eye to eye. The goal was to help all three groups better understand the others, their needs, their motivations, and also the political, judicial, and legal challenges facing the state of Georgia. We have a really terrific program for the day. For the full rundown, you can use the bit.ly or QR code that is on the screen to go to the agenda, the bios, and any additional materials for the individual panels. We'll have a working lunch in a few hours, so please plan to pick up your box in the lobby and then return to this room at your convenience. I want to remind everyone that there will also be a reception at the end of the program, and it's a really great opportunity to meet the organizers and the participants. I also want to recognize the sponsors whose contributions go so far to support this conference. The names are now on the screen, and I would like to highlight just a few of them for you to give particular shout-outs to the State Bar of Georgia for its ongoing partnership and for generously providing the venue and your parking, as well as CNN, the Atlanta Journal-Constitution, the various judges' councils of Georgia, the Administrative Office of the Courts, UGA's First Amendment Clinic, and UGA's Department of Journalism, in which case I am enthusiastically thanking myself, and no doubt I deserve it. This conference would not have come together but for the tireless work of the volunteer members of the Planning Committee, and I especially want to thank this year's program co-chairs. Frank Lamonti of CNN. I have told Frank this before, that I'm convinced that there are actually six Frank Lamontis. And that is because every time I attend a conference, he's there when I arrive and still there when I leave. And if I go straight to another conference, by the time I get there, he has been there for 3 days. So he was the chair of chairs this year, and I'm immensely grateful for all of the hard work that he put into the program. Next up, Claire Norens of the UGA First Amendment Clinic and Richard Griffiths of the First Amendment Foundation. They were both indispensable collaborators and co-conspirators as we developed panel ideas, recruited participants, prepared promotional materials, and much more. Before I turn things over to the moderator of the first panel, I'd be remiss as president if I did not say a few words about the Georgia First Amendment Foundation. Free expression and information access are at the heart of American democratic life. It demands that citizens be informed to participate meaningfully in public affairs. We need to know and be able to speak freely about what is happening around Georgia in city halls, county courthouses, state commissions, police departments, and public schools. That access enables us to vote knowledgeably, to hold government officials accountable, and to engage in productive debates and discussions about difficult political, social, and economic issues. At the Georgia First Amendment Foundation, we work in that spirit to advocate for free expression and information access across the state. We fight for open records and meetings. We defend the rights of peaceful protesters. We deliver training to public officials and journalists, and we produce educational resources to explain the law. We are honored to serve the public interest, and we are grateful that you're here today to explore issues at the intersection of journalism, courts, and the law. With that said, I'm happy to yield the floor now to Jonathan Ringel, the Senior Vice President of Posting Communications, who will moderate the session on high-profile criminal trials, if only, of course, we had any examples in Georgia to discuss. So, Jonathan, take it away.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jonathan. Why don't I go ahead and give you the clicker? I'll move it forward.
Clicker device.
Ah, there you go. If you're just going to take the clicker. Let me go ahead and ask our panel to come up, and I'll introduce them as they do. Judge Timothy Walmsley was appointed to the Superior Court of the Eastern District Judicial District in February 2012 by Governor Nathan Deal. And he's been elected to additional full 4-year terms since then. Important to this discussion, Judge Walmsley presided over the trial of 3 men accused of murdering Ahmaud Arbery in Brunswick, Georgia. The trial garnered national attention and resulted in the conviction of all 3 defendants. District Attorney Sherry Boston was elected to the Stone Mountain Judicial District in 2016 and has been re-elected since then. She's also served as DeKalb County Solicitor General, and again, helpful for our discussion, she knows both sides of the courtroom as she started her legal career as a defense attorney. Professor Eric Siegel teaches federal courts and constitutional law at Georgia State University College of Law. He's the author of books and articles on constitutional law, and those works have also appeared in multiple law reviews and newspapers. He's an advocate of cameras in the courtrooms, including appellate courts and the Supreme Court. And finally, Dale Russell was a TV investigative journalist for 43 years until last year. He has covered countless trials and can tell us how journalists approach these issues. I guess I'll stay here if it's okay with you and not sit down. I kind of like standing. But as Jonathan alluded to, just down the road is the Fulton County Courthouse, where last week was the subject of what some people would call must-see TV, with hearings regarding the trial of, or the upcoming trial of, the former President of the United States. Actually, just a show of hands, how many people watched some of that last week? Okay. So it's interesting to consider what that event would have been like without television cameras, and you can imagine either that was pro or con. There are 2 schools of thought when it comes to the benefits and risks of televising trials, and in particular the trial of something highly controversial. Our discussion will certainly have the Trump case in the background. Some people may discuss it specifically, others may want to speak only in risk of saying generalities. They will speak in, with something applying to all types of cases. But I want to start with Judge Walmsley. Having presided over a television trial, a trial that was televised, a great national interest, what do you see the pros and cons being for televising a trial?
Well, first, thank you for the invitation to speak here. And
mic closer, please. Thank you.
Now, can everybody hear me?
Yes.
Okay. First, thank you for invitation to come speak. And that question could probably be addressed in a 4-hour presentation of its own. 2 things before I start. I just want to make sure that everybody's clear on what I'm going to be talking about. First is the Arbery case is still pending in my courtroom, so I'm not going to address anything having to do with the Arbery case directly, other than procedural things and things that we did. And I'm also not going to comment on what's going on in Fulton County and Judge McAfee's courtroom. That's just inappropriate, and I'm not going to answer any questions on that. So what I'm going to talk about is generalities a little bit. So the pros and cons. The experience we had down in Brunswick was a unique experience. I assume many in the courtroom did watch that trial. My position all along was that it needed to be televised, that it needed to be shown to the public in a format that was understandable and could be digested by the public, because it is my position, and I think, I can't speak for this, it's my position that the sunlight is the greatest disinfectant, right? So The courts are a mystery to most. And I think what's going on up here in Fulton County is probably a good indication of that. Because they are a mystery, people develop narratives. They take on stories, or they produce stories that sort of fit into those narratives by televising these proceedings. And we live stream now. Many of the courts live stream. I was talking to the judge of the Court of Appeals. The Court of Appeals is live streaming. What we do is we give the public access to what we do and an understanding of what we do. And hopefully, with that understanding, there is not just an appreciation for what's going on in the courtroom, but an acceptance of results. And so that's why I think it's important that we make sure that the public gets as much information as they can about what's going on, particularly in these high-profile cases.
Okay. District Attorney Boston, what when you know one of your cases is going to get televised, what are your biggest concerns, and are there any benefits to your side as well? I mean, one that I can think of is that the entire world will see your prosecutor delivering lots of damning evidence against the defendant, you know, that could make some 2 minutes of TV news.
Yes, so I think for when we talk about the televised trial and what that does for either the prosecution or the defense, I would say for my prosecutors, you know, people think, well, if you're talking to everyone in the room and you're comfortable handling your case, that somehow that makes you less nervous when you know you're being broadcast sometimes around the world. And what I can tell you is that's not the case. Most of my prosecutors are not really excited when a Rule 22 gets filed and they know that that particular trial is going to be live streamed. Because it adds an additional layer of them feeling like they're being watched and critiqued by the world. But I also, like Judge Walmsley, believe that there are these types of cases that are unique and have such public interest that the world wants to see and oftentimes needs to see justice being done. Now, obviously, you know, we can all talk about the case going on in Fulton County, and that's broadcast around the world. And in fact, I was outside the country when I tuned in to must-see TV. But I would say, you know, it is not unusual to have trials being televised. We have one happening in DeKalb right now with a cult leader that is accused of committing a number of violent sexual crimes within his so-called religion. And that case is being live streamed, and we have people as far away as a broadcast organization in London that have flown in to cover the trial gavel to gavel. So, you know, from a prosecution standpoint, it means that the world is watching. It also means that we have to take additional, generally, security precautions. I don't think many people recognize and understand the idea that it's very different when you are trying a case that people have opinions about, and we now live in a society where with social media, and access from the world, that it now makes your prosecutors, your witnesses, your defense lawyers, anyone in the courtroom can now be easily recognizable and found. And so we have to take a lot more precautions and security plans for our prosecutors when we know that their face is going to be broadcast across multimediums. And they have to be prepared because obviously, if they make mistakes or flub or flunder, then also everybody gets to see that as well. So it's not just mistakes that you might make that are only seen by the 50 people that have come down to the courtroom, but now you potentially have millions of people, and also these things can become memes and parts of monologues on, you know, comedic political shows at night. So it does open up a door of a host of other ways that that video can be used outside of the regular viewing of a courtroom proceeding.
Okay. Thank you. Professor Siegel, one of the reasons that some courts have been reticent to let the cameras in, at least one of the arguments is, that this will change somebody's performance. The lawyers, the judge, or a witness will turn the trial into some sort of broader TV performance, something to get a reaction beyond the courtroom. Yet, most states now allow TV coverage of trials. And I was wondering if you think that experience has kind of soundly defeated those arguments. And yet, I'll ask one other sort of you to consider this as well. In the trial that could occur here in Fulton County, the number one defendant is not shy about TV coverage and can turn an appearance into literally a campaign event, given that he's running for office. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, good morning. It's great to be back here. I've been at this conference every few years for the last 30 years, and I really enjoy it every time. I think when we talk about the perils of criminal trials on television, it is very hard for those of us of a certain age to wipe away the O.J. Simpson memories. Because I think the O.J. Simpson trial showed the downsides of having these trials on television. But I don't think we should leap from that to the trial shouldn't be on television, which is what a lot of people did back in the day. There are a lot of downsides, security, heightened pressures to having cameras in courtrooms, and that not just trial courtrooms, but all courtrooms. We can list those downsides for the next 2 hours, but it doesn't matter. The upside is way more important, which is the American people should see how their government works. And if the hearing is open to the public, which almost all of these trials are, and if there's an interest in seeing it, and if it doesn't cost the taxpayers a whole lot of money to televise it, then I don't care what the other side is. The transparency arguments win. The democracy arguments win. The disinfectant arguments win. And I have to say, as someone who's been fighting for cameras in appellate courts for about 30 years, both of you, your statements really inspired me, because I wish more people felt the way you did, both of you. Because it's one thing to say, of course there are costs. There are downsides. But they're not as significant as the upsides. So for example, last week, we're all watching the Trump trial. And what's happening in real time is constitutional law professors and criminal, mostly criminal law professors, but all of us, we're having a conversation on social media about this trial in real time, which, now there's gonna be a lot of misinformation there too from non-experts, but if you just follow the experts in real time, then we can learn a lot about what's going on in real time. And that moment of civic engagement is something this country desperately needs, even if it's something as, you know, kind of tragic as what's going on in Fulton County for our political system. It is just so important. And I had so many people write to me on social media saying, thank you for kind of live tweeting this as it was going on. I don't think, if there's ever going to be a showboating trial, I think last week's trial in Fulton County would be it. But there wasn't it. The lawyers did their jobs professionally. Some got mad, but lawyers get mad all the time in court. I don't think that trial would have been any different had it not been on television.
And really?
I don't think the lawyers would have done anything different. I don't think the judge would have done anything different.
And the district attorney would not have done anything different.
I don't know. Okay, that's a little more complicated, but I don't think so, actually. I think the district attorney's, whatever the facts of this are, she was sincerely, I think the public has the right to see their DA express the feelings the DA wants to express about this very public happening. And I'm pretty confident she was glad it was on television. I don't know that for her, but I'm pretty glad. I'm pretty sure she was. So I guess the bottom line is we can have a discussion about the negatives, and there are some negatives for it. And I think the O.J. Simpson trial shows some of the negatives. But at the end of the day, so one last thing I'll say is I have a blog post out this morning about the First Amendment and how, I'm sorry if this shocked people, but it's just made up by the Supreme Court. There's nothing in the original meaning of the First Amendment that justifies any First Amendment doctrine you can think of, except for prior restraints. It's just made up stuff. There should have been at some point in our Supreme Court history, and there may be someday, the idea that the press does get special treatment, which this Supreme Court doesn't believe, and the press has a constitutional right to cover these trials. I would like that someday to be the law of this country. With the understanding that if there are compelling security reasons, privacy reasons, then no, you know, but in the general trial, the press should have a right to be there. We're not there yet, but I hope someday we get there.
So let me, oh.
I was just going to say, I think Peter and Tom and a few other people in this room can help you on that. go ahead.
Well, what I was going to say is I think, you know, we can't talk about TV trials in a vacuum. So when we talk about the O.J. Simpson trial, which I think is probably the first trial I ever saw on TV, but it's probably also the first trial that I ever watched, right, with interest as a viewer. Just before I went to law school. And so what I think we are seeing is not just the evolution of the televised trial, we are looking at the evolution of the televised trial alongside social media and its influence on TV trials. And on any court proceeding. I can say that where we really started to have a lot of concerns was when the world shut down during the COVID pandemic. And the only way for many courts to comply with the public hearings requirements when buildings were closed was opening up Zoom rooms to all proceedings. And when everyone was at home and there wasn't much to do, courtroom proceedings that people didn't normally watch, like bond hearings and preliminary hearings and first appearances, which, by the way, if you've ever done these things, are extremely boring, became the most exciting thing of your day. When you were stuck at home, working perhaps with your kids, pulling at your hair, you needed some level of entertainment. And the thing that made it entertaining was not necessarily the proceedings that were happening, but the chat box that was associated on the side or the bottom of the screen. It became the real-time commentary by people watching from all over the country. And so to me, when we talk about the televised trial, we really also have to talk about the commentary that is flowing into that. Not just the live tweeting from experts, right, who are giving their academic or expert, you know, play-by-play, but the regular everyday layperson that knows nothing about the law but is interjecting their thoughts and opinions play by play of what's happening. And I think that is something that we really need to look at and is changing the face of the televised trial.
Go ahead. Ultimately, I understand the whole thing with social media. I try to stay off social media as much as possible, but as far as influence, speaking from the experience that I had, it doesn't matter what's going on in social media. I mean, people have, the public has a right of access, subject to media, that I'll let you hang on to that. But the public has a right of access. Right? Anyone can come into the courtroom and watch what's going on, and they can comment on it. That's their right. Whether they do that to a friend, whether they do that on Facebook, whether they do it on whatever, Instagram, whatever the social media they're using are, they can do that. It should not have any influence ultimately on what's happening in the courtroom. So that to me, at least again, given my experience, the Arbery case we tried as a murder case. It was a murder case. And in Superior Court, we try murder cases regularly. Now it was a murder case on steroids, but I don't look at social media to see what people had to say about Judge Walmsley. I'm sure people had some pretty strong opinions about it, as they probably did about the defense lawyers and the prosecutors and the witnesses and everybody else. But sitting in the courtroom, it didn't matter.
I want to ask Dale Russell to jump in real quick. Dale, just from the journalist perspective, what, you know, I know that you would naturally be a supporter of cameras in the courtroom, but what are the challenges for the journalists putting a camera there? There are some responsibilities and some things that either you're asked not to do or you shouldn't do. Tell us about those.
First of all, I could say everything Eric said and agree with everything he said, and I think that would be pretty obvious. But a couple of points on this, because we've argued over this my entire career. I want everybody to think about a couple of things that if you're in a small community and there's a trial of importance going on in your community, in the old days, you could get up and go down to the courthouse and sit in that room and watch it. Well, Donald Trump case in Fulton County, all the citizens that are interested in being in that courtroom and seeing it for themselves are not going to be able to get into that courtroom. And in my mind, cameras, all they're doing is opening the courts to the citizens who have an interest in what's going on in that court in the same way that it's open to them to get up and drive down or take a horse down and go down and go into that courtroom and watch what's going on. And I've always sort of seen it that way. The other thing I want, in terms of the challenges, I am in the Fannie Willis, in that case, the Trump case, I think is a perfect example of this. I believe, as a broadcast journalist, that we do our best coverage with recordings and cameras because we bring it to a viewer or a listener unfiltered, unvarnished. So think about waking up in the morning and reading the AJC about Fannie Willis held up a document and said, these are lies. And you're reading that in the paper. Now think about the image. When Fannie held those two court documents up and her voice is full of emotion and her face shows her anger and she's telling you, these are lies. Completely different visceral experience and I believe more authentic representation of what happened in that courtroom. The most gifted print writer in the world, and I love the print writers, cannot capture that, especially on deadline. But that's what I want people to understand, is that we're giving the best of what's going on in that courtroom. When I say the best, the most accurate, the most authentic of what is going on in that courtroom, because we're giving you those images for you to decide, you to look at. Does Fannie look like she really believes this? Is this a show? Is she just trying to convince people? Is she playing to the cameras? You get to see her. You get to make those decisions yourself as a viewer or a listener. And that's why I think it is just vitally important from a journalistic point of view and actually from the citizenry point of view to have cameras and recordings in the courtroom.
Professor Stiegel, what you were going
to
ask?
I just want to go back to the social media part of this. I don't think it doesn't matter. Here's what I mean by that. In the normal case that no one cares about, it doesn't matter. And that chat just goes into the ether someplace and no one ever cares again. But what's happening with the Trump trial and what's happened with some other high-profile trials in Georgia is commentary, especially by local professors, in this case, my colleague Professor Christ and my colleague Professor Cunningham, have been right at the top of the food chain when it comes to reporting on the Trump trial. What they put on social media ends up on MSNBC. And what ends up on MSNBC ends up in the public. And there are some real downsides to this and there are some upsides to this, but there's also an inevitability to it that we have to accept because this is the world we're living in and we're not going back. But I do think if you televise an expert on prosecutors in rural Georgia who can comment on this trial by watching it. I have a former student, actually, who's a prominent defense attorney in this state, and he has been commenting a lot on this trial and he, from a defense perspective. And his perspective is being picked up by the media. And that gets then distributed all across America. So I don't think we can ignore the social media impact of this, but I think, and there are upsides and there are downsides. But it doesn't matter. The debate over whether it should happen or not is over. We're not putting this toothpaste back in the thing. And I do think that the public is getting slightly better at discerning real commentary from the commentary that should end up in the ether someplace.
So my point is a little bit different than that. My point is from the court standpoint, we do what we do in the courtroom, whether there's a camera there or not, and the public has a right of access. What the media, and when I say media, I'm not just talking about formal media, but also social media, all of the people that are commenting, you know, that's our sort of media. the narratives that are produced by those individuals are something quite separate from what's going on in the courtroom. And that is an issue I really can't address. Being the judge in the courtroom, all I can do is my work. But I will say, the Aubrey case, there were certain narratives out there that people wished to publish. So they found facts, they found video clips that fit those narratives. I think that's not on the court to police. We need to provide the information and make sure that the public knows what really happened in the courtroom, as opposed to whatever those narratives may be and another person's personal opinion about how things should have gone. So so it's a little bit different from my perspective.
Judge Walmsley, I have a thought. Under what circumstances would you or can a judge issue a gag order about people, participants talking outside the courtroom?
And unfortunately, that's something I'm not going to comment on. There was a gag order issue in the Aubrey case.
Oh.
And so I'm not going to comment on
that. Okay. Sherry Boston.
Yes.
You've probably been around those circumstances before. I'm imagining a participant in a trial walking out at the end of the day, standing on the courthouse steps and saying, everything you saw today on TV was a lie, and maybe even someone saying, I didn't even mean it. Just turning the chessboard upside down. Can a judge, and under what circumstances would a judge issue a gag order, or perhaps would your office want one?
Yeah, so I have an example of that right now. The case that's being televised prior to the proceeding starting, we did seek an emergency gag order because of some of the things that were being done by the person charged. A lot of that was on social media. They had their own YouTube station and were publicizing information about witnesses and what they were going to say and what they know. So we went to the court and said, this could be considered intimidation. This could influence our jury pool. And so in that case, the judge did say, no more. Your friends, your family, everybody involved cannot be posting about the facts and circumstances and the evidence of this case prior to the start of the trial. So there are instances where, again, we have to protect the integrity of the proceedings, and we have to protect the jury pool from being tainted, but also we have to protect our potential witnesses because sometimes those types of discussions and things that are being talked about can influence whether witnesses then want to come to court and give truthful testimony. And so it is incumbent upon the court, if either side brings information to the court that would support a gag order, that neither side be allowed to talk about the specifics of the case prior to getting into the courtroom, into those proceedings. That is oftentimes very important.
But is that realistically enforced?
Oh, absolutely. It's absolutely enforced. I think when you see either a prosecutor or a defense lawyer go to a judge, they're going to have to show the judge why, like, what the other side is doing is harmful or to the case. And trust and believe, if that judge issues an order, the other side will make sure it's enforced, or there will be, sanctions.
Okay. One of the, there was an article in the New York Times over the summer around the time of the indictment in the Trump trial, where a former U.S. Assistant U.S. attorney made the argument that the Trump trial should not be, and he was talking, I think, about all four of them, should not be televised. And his argument was that he, as a former prosecutor, had always had a very difficult time getting witnesses to testify, especially in organized crime matters. You're nodding, you've had this problem. And saying that for the sake of protecting that the evidence that those witnesses would bring, ratcheting down the pressure by keeping these trials off of the air, was the right thing to do. You've been through that you're, you know, you've been through that. So what are your thoughts?
I don't agree with keeping, and maybe, you know, not to disparage any of my wonderful friends that are federal prosecutors, but as a federal prosecutor, since cameras are not allowed in the courtroom, you've never had to navigate that arena. Mm-hmm. So of course you default to the system that you know, which is, we don't have cameras in the courtroom, everything's fine. We have sketch artists. I bet a lot of judges don't like the sketches. I can tell you, some of them are like, I wouldn't want anybody sketching me. Picture is definitely better. But having said that, I think as a state prosecutor, and especially here in Georgia, where we do have, we expect cameras to be in the courtroom, we've had to adapt and adjust. So yes, when we have sensitive information, whether it is victims of sex crimes, child victims, or in the case of witnesses that are testifying about sensitive information, where their life may be in danger, where they are testifying and knowing that they're putting themselves at risk, we absolutely engage with the court to make sure that we limit that person's image from being placed on TV. So there are ways, just like we would sometimes with child victims, we are allowed to ask the court to close the courtroom temporarily to even the public being there for the safety and security of a child victim. So that doesn't go away with the media. We take those same precautions, and we know that our journalists also have a duty and a responsibility to also make sure they comply with protecting the identities of sex victims and child victims. So judges are taking that all into consideration, and it is, they are making sure that within those courtrooms, that those lines are not crossed when it comes to protecting victims or witnesses that may be at risk.
Dale Russell, what are the challenges for the news media when that kind of issue comes up, where the court tells you, you know, don't point this camera at this person, or we're going to close the courtroom for this part of the session?
I don't know that there is a challenge, because when the judge tells me to do that, I do that. It's pretty simple in some respects, but we deal with this all the time, what Sherry's talking about. It's routine. When I read that editorial when it came out, and I just shook my head that, I mean, I've covered child molestation cases where, as Sherry said, the courtroom was closed, or we couldn't videotape the children. Covered rape cases where we couldn't show the victim, or sometimes we can't show the name. I even there was one case where, if I remember this right, they put up some sort of shield in front of the witness stand where the woman testifying, we couldn't see her. Also to make sure that the cameras didn't capture her or record her. But as Sherry says, there's all kind of ways to protect the sensitive people that are in a sensitive situation that are testifying in a trial, and certainly could do that in a case like the Donald Trump case that's in Fulton County. I thought it was an absurd editorial in my viewpoint. I didn't think it sounded like someone who never covered or been in a state or a superior court to me, because I think, and I hope Sherry would agree with me, as journalists, we have no problem going along with these guidelines. We don't put up a fuss or a fight. I don't call my lawyer and say, come down here and fight this for me. We totally understand the sensitivity in many of these cases that we're covering, and totally understand why a judge would guide or maybe even do some of the things that we inherently, you know, bristle at. We get it, I think. Most the mainstream journalists that I've worked with over the years, some of the social media types and the independent types, that's a whole different ballgame, and I can't speak for them.
I agree. Understand, certainly no one's going to want to put the victim of a child molestation up on a screen, but I can imagine in a trial like the Trump trial would be, there could be some witnesses who are politicians who just don't want to be the fodder for the Jimmy Kimmel show the next day, but they may say, you know what, this is bad for me. Would you think you call your lawyers then, Dale? if they said, you know, we're not going to show Rudy Giuliani?
Yes.
Okay.
A couple of things. I mean, there is a big difference between already being a public figure making you a public figure.
All right, I'm imagining maybe the elections chief of, elections official, and maybe that's a better example.
So there's an old Supreme Court case in a different area that says the possible abuse of a power is not an argument against the lawful abuse of that power. It's an old Commerce Clause case. There are times when televising criminal trials, and maybe even appellate proceedings in some situations, high-profile foreign policy type cases, we're going to have to do some bending and some moving around and some maneuvering, and judges are going to issue reasonable orders. And maybe some of those times they're going to overshoot to protect, undershoot to protect. And we have to be careful about that and pay attention to it. And it's important, especially if a witness wants privacy. If a witness wants privacy, and there's no issue of the witness's wrongdoing, that has to be taken seriously. But all that is exceptions to the rule that in a democracy, an open governmental hearing, which is already open to the public, needs to be open to whichever part of the public wants to see it, unless the financial cost is too great. And so, again, I just want to say, yes, we have to do this carefully, and there may be certain trials where we have to move things around. That editorial, which I saw also, I thought, I was shocked at times. Published it, I thought it was terrible. And you're right, the author clearly had not ever really been involved in this kind of process. And it's my kind of understanding after 30 years of teaching this stuff that most judges, well certainly all judges in Georgia that I know, but even nationally, take these obligations seriously. And if there is a need for privacy, they're going to insist on privacy. And if there's not a need for privacy, then they won't. And will they get that wrong sometimes? Of course, they're fallible. But that doesn't mean we shouldn't do it. It just means we do it carefully. And I'm tired of after arguing for this for 30 years, of people making all these arguments that are valid, but can also be accommodated to all the things you're talking about. And I don't think it's that much more complicated than that. The presumption should be public hearings are on TV. If there's a compelling reason not to, then we won't do it.
Jonathan, can I ask a question,
please?
It's my nature, I'm sorry. I'm curious about, and I've heard this a lot from prosecutors and judges about the camera's impact, the way people testify, or the way that people act in the courtroom. Do you both believe that if it became more and more standard, that the cameras were in there all the time, or they're streaming from the courthouse, like now I can go down to the Fulton County website and see the Trump trial on the judge's webpage, with four cameras shooting, it's much better than the cameras that we bring in. But if it becomes more common, is it going to be better? Is it going to resolve some of those problems and issues that you both mentioned?
I'll tell you, we stream in Chatham County. There's a small camera. You know, the cameras these days are really quite unobtrusive.
Yes.
I'll go back to Aubrey. I think we had three or four cameras in the courtroom, all on pivots, and we had rules that we had put in place with the media about jury couldn't be videoed, and there were certain things that couldn't be shown, and those were complied with. I don't know the answer. I mean, different people react differently to the cameras. I have not seen it as a major issue in the courtroom. Witnesses in particular don't play to the camera. Mm-hmm. There are always exceptions, and whatever's going on in Fulton County, I guess we'll see how that all plays out. But let's talk about what we do day to day, and that is folks are coming into a courtroom, and there's something very sacrosanct about a courtroom, at least I believe, and I think most people who come into a courtroom, it's not the most comfortable place to be, even for lawyers, and most people are on their best behavior and understand that there are certain rules that they need to comply with, and for the most part comply, and if they don't, then there's recourse through the court. We can go ahead and get that figured out. But just simply having, at least right now, I've got a live stream camera that sits in my courtroom and press a button and we go ahead. I don't know the long term. I think people are very comfortable with cameras now. I mean, we all have cameras, everybody here has a camera sitting on the phone. And I'm sure a bunch of people took a variety of pictures this morning. So I don't know, there's a comfort level I think people have that maybe wasn't there 10 years ago.
There's an aspect of this that we haven't talked about that I think is really important, more for the federal system. And it's sad that we don't have cameras in the federal system. There are judges in the federal system in their 90s, all across the country, because of life tenure, the insanity of life tenure. And some of these judges, I had cases when I was in the Department of Justice with judges acting badly. I'm sorry, but life tenured federal judges acting badly. It would be nice if the public could see that. It would, and they might, and frankly, they might act less bad if they were on camera. We never talk about this from the judge's perspective. It's always the witnesses, the jury, mm-hmm. the parties. But the reality is I've had experiences in federal courthouses that are embarrassing, and the public should have seen those experiences.
Okay. Judge Walmsley, I mean, it's interesting to think that of the four cases that have been brought against the former president, only one is in a jurisdiction that allows cameras, Georgia. New York, the state of New York is the rarity that doesn't allow it. If the state of New York suddenly decided to allow them, and a judge in New York called you and said, "Judge, for the first time in my life, I got cameras in my courtroom. What should I know?" What would you tell them?
Well, just you try the case the way you try the case. It should not matter.
Is there really, I mean, there's not even just...
I made the comment earlier that with the Aubrey case, it's a murder case. It's a certain type of case, and that's how we do it. I mean, the moment you start considering how to deal with the cameras, it changes the way that you try the case. So the best thing to do is, again, just try your case. The cameras, again, it's not so much the cameras. The public has a right to be there. There's people there anyway. So I tell lawyers to do this. I tell a lot of people I speak to, students and otherwise. You know, it comes right down to it. With everything that we do in life, just be professional and be prepared. Try your case. People are going to have. I mean, the bigger issue isn't so much the cameras. It's what we're talking about here: social media and people commenting about it. People have opinions about what we do, and as public figures, so be it. So my comment would be. Make sure you know when the cameras are on and off, mm-hmm. so you're not caught in a really candid moment. but other than that, just try your case.
Chair Boston, wait, what do you tell your prosecutors who like, say, "Oh my God, I don't want to do this. I don't want to be on TV."
Well, you don't have a choice, okay. Right? Like, I mean, but they
or,
know.
Or how do they deal with the someone makes a mistake that somehow is funny, it gets on TV, it's a meme, everyone's talking about it on social media. How do you counsel them through it?
Well, a couple things. I mean, this brings to light that, you know, really with cameras in the courtroom, you just don't want to find yourself in what we all refer to as a hot mic moment, right? You don't have to have a camera to understand what a hot mic moment is, but a video can equally be a hot mic moment for anyone that's mic'd up or right in front of some angle that, again, as Judge Walmsley pointed out, they are so unintrusive that you might even forget for a moment that, you know, that someone is seeing even your facial reactions in high definition, right? And so you do have to maintain a different level of composure sometimes because that can be elevated to the world. But as far as what we say to our prosecutors in high profile cases or televised cases, I just remind them, first of all, we tell them, do not, under any circumstances, go on social media at night and look for the comments that people are going to make. It will not end well, ever, right? Tell your friends and family to refrain from printing out, reading to you, or telling you about said social media comments, right? We really, because it's going to happen, and we don't want to, it's not about influencing the trial as much as it's deflating. Right? You don't want to hear that, you know, half of America thinks that you need a better hairstyle. I mean, we're all human, right? None of us likes to be critiqued, but we certainly don't want to think that everyone is talking about us, even when they are. That is distracting because I want my prosecutors to focus on the job they're doing, not on the side commentary that people are going to inevitably make when you're doing it. So we always say, stay off even local media, right? You don't need to see what you looked like when you asked that question. You don't need to see or focus on any of those things. Don't read the playback. don't even think about it. Focus on the trial. But I want to just kind of comment on, will witnesses or people play to cameras? I agree, they don't. When we're prosecuting a crime, the biggest moment that we all know that can happen in a criminal trial is if the defendant chooses to take the stand. And that's always going to be a big moment, whether you're sitting at home watching it or whether you're in the courtroom. And I can think of a televised trial most recently that we had that was of large interest to the legal community, in particular here in Georgia, was the trial of Richard Merritt, you know, who was a former prosecutor and prominent cop attorney who went on the lam after killing his mother when he had been sentenced to jail for stealing money from his clients, right? And then he commits this murder of his mother and then goes, you know, absconds for a year and a half. So when we get him back, not only does the world want to watch the trial, and that trial was streamed cover to cover and went on to be on killer cases and that kind of thing, but I can't tell you the number of lawyers that were texting me like, hey, what time's the trial start? There was an interest, right, of the legal community who knew this man, and unfortunately we all love a fall from grace a little bit too much, but who were like, I can't get down to the courthouse, right? I'm busy, I'm doing this. But they were tuning in to live stream, especially when they learned that he, in fact, a lawyer, was gonna put himself on the stand and testify about what happened to his mother. And I will tell you, I'll raise my hand and say, that was live streaming, but I walked myself down to the courtroom because I said, I've gotta see this live and in person. Like, this is going to happen. It's a moment. And I say that to say is, I don't think that Richard Merritt acted any differently because the cameras were in the courtroom. I think when someone takes the stand and makes a decision that they're going to tell an outlandish story in court, and I think the judge can probably relate to this, that when that happens, that was gonna happen anyway. The fact that the camera's there to capture it just gives everyone else an opportunity to replay, did he really say that the next day? And I think those are important moments. It doesn't change what he was gonna do, but it definitely changed for me because I wanted to see it actually with my own eyes and not just, you know, someone's words in the television in the paper the next day.
Sherry, can I follow up on this? First of all, tell your prosecutors that high definition is one of the reasons men wear makeup on TV. I'm just saying, high definition is brutal. But what you just said to me is so important, and I wanted to make this point at some point today. And I want to plant this seed, and I want everyone in this audience who's going to be part of this debate down the road to just think about this, because I don't hear it that often. What you just said brings me to what one of the reasons I think is so important to have cameras in this courtroom. My phone started talking to me. It's history. We are capturing history as it happens. And think of all the amazing trials that you've all studied in law school, that you've read about, and that you've heard about over the years. You have no idea what it looked like or what it sounded like because there were no cameras in the courtroom. And they say that journalists write the first draft of history. One of the things I love about the cameras is that we are capturing history for the next few generations. For those one in a million trials that are going to be historic, that are going to be written about and read about and talked about for decades and decades and decades. I covered the Wayne Williams trial in 1981. That's how old I am. And no cameras in the courtroom. I don't think Lewis Slayton wanted all this that we're talking about. He wanted this to be as clean as possible at that point in time. There was a camera for the press corps because there were too many press people there to be able to get into the courtroom. But when I think back on that, when I think of the moments in that trial, and Wayne Williams is on the witness stand, almost screaming at Joe Drolet that you want the real Wayne Williams, well, you've got him now. And then he goes into this, you know, hard, harsh, demeanor that he had hidden through the entire trial. That's history. We don't have it. I saw it, but I'm guessing most of the people here have never seen that. And that's an amazing moment to me that we've lost by not having those cameras in the courtroom. In the Richard Merritt case or whatever the case is, could, can you imagine Donald Trump, a former president, being tried on a RICO case and no historic record of it visually or from an audio point of view? All we have is the written record. It defies logic to me, and it's one of the biggest reasons I want to see cameras in these courtrooms.
And I just want to add to that, when I was asked to do this, I was very flattered to be asked. I did want to spend a couple minutes on the Supreme Court issue, because that's what I've been writing about for 30 years. Everything you just said counts 1,000 times more. I cannot show my students the oral arguments in Brown and Roe and Citizens United. I can play it for them, and I can have still pictures of them. It's not the same thing. And I want to prove why it's not the same thing, if I may. There was a huge affirmative action argument years ago, before the court ended all that, in a case called Fisher versus Texas, where Justice Scalia made some really, bigoted comments about how he doesn't really care if there aren't black people at the University of Texas. Maybe they don't belong there anyway, is basically what he said. It's horrible. And it was reported in the press by the Supreme Court press corps that were there. But a friend of mine who was actually in the courtroom that day, and you can hear it, you can play it back and hear it. Then it was a week later, now it's live. But here's the difference. Very progressive members of the media who I respect, who were in the courtroom that day, say, if you had seen Scalia's mannerisms and his body language, it was much less terrible than it sounds. I mean, it was terrible. But it was less terrible than it sounds. Because body language matters. And tone, you can kind of get that on the audio, but not really. And for example, Justice Thomas slept through most of your arguments in the 2000s. He did. I'm serious. His eyes were closed and he was like this. And we never saw that. He never asked a question. He went 10 years asking no questions. Had the Supreme Court been on television, there's no way Justice Thomas goes 10 years without asking a question. And we know this because once it was live streamed, he started asking questions again. It is vitally important to this democracy that these Supreme Court oral arguments be seen. And the fact that I can't show my students the oral arguments in the upcoming the disqualification case that just happened is insane. And the last point is, this generation, I have two teenage daughters, this generation learns visually. I mean, there's a podcast thing out there, but mostly it's visual learning. And they don't want to sit down and hear something, they want to watch it on their phone. We have to get Supreme Court hearings on TV.
Richard, do we have time for Q&A?
Yes, absolutely. You've still got 15 minutes.
Oh, wow. Okay. Does anybody have a comment or question for our panel? Yes.
Thank you for asking. My name is Nydia Tisdale. I am a citizen journalist, and Dale Russell was the first person to ever interview me. And I have recorded numerous court proceedings. And the Rule 22 was in fact changed such that cameras can only be rolling while the judge is inside the courtroom. And so you miss the greetings, the welcome, the hello, the goodbye, the hug, the tears before and after if the judge is not in fact inside the courtroom. The Rule 22 was changed. I was filming a very prominent trial, it was a week long, and I caught during a break two lawyers joking about their legal fees with both of their clients in the courtroom during the break. The rule was subsequently changed.
Suggested by Ms. Jones. Rollins, how old are you?
71.
And what is your occupation?
I'm a businessman, an executive.
And you've been divorced, obviously, from Ms. Rollins since February 12, 2012.
Can you repeat that?
You've been divorced since February 12, 2013, correct?
Correct.
Puts on 50. And that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. Lord.
Do you have a YouTube channel that people...
I do.
Does anybody have a comment or question for our panel? Yes.
Thank you for asking. My name is Nydia Tisdale. I am a citizen journalist, and Dale Russell was the first person to ever interview me. And I have recorded numerous court proceedings, and the Rule 22 was in fact changed such that cameras can only be rolling while the judge is inside the courtroom. And so you miss the greetings, the welcome, the hello, the goodbye, the hug, the tears before and after if the judge is not in fact inside the courtroom. The Rule 22 was changed. I was filming a very prominent trial. It was a week long, and I caught during a break two lawyers joking about their legal fees with both of their clients in the courtroom during the break. The rule was subsequently changed. I would like your opinion about not allowing the camera to continue rolling once the judge has exited the courtroom.
Anybody?
Not sure where to go with that. The proceeding begins when the judge takes the bench, and it ends when the judge steps off the bench, and that's what Rule 22 addresses. It was changed, actually, not to address that. I think a few years ago, the changes were mainly because of the proliferation of phones in the court. Folks were bringing phones in and videotaping proceedings with telephones. So I don't have much of I haven't really thought about it beyond that, but again, to the court proceeding begins, we take the bench and we step off.
Nydia, I remember a million years ago, I worked at the company C-SPAN, and I remember hearing a lot about the theory behind the way they start and end their events, where they often, their coverage, they will show the beginning, the people filing in and filing out, and that's always an interesting aspect of their coverage. Any other questions or thoughts? Yes, ma'am.
Hi, hello, I'm Tony. I'm a student, journalism student at Georgia State University.
Hold on 1 second, we're gonna get a microphone to you.
Thank you so much, sir. Hi, hello, I'm Tony O'Dejmi. I am a journalism student at Georgia State University. You made a comment about the difference between independent journalists and journalists that work at a company, let's say CNN, the AJC, the New York Times. So let's say an independent journalist that has a Substack or a freelancer that's only working at a company for a specific story, how are they going to work with getting credentialed about the logistics of all the things that we're talking about when the Circus comes to town, with covering these trials with respect, and more so just a larger question, how can we make it so that we can bridge that relationship gap between the courts and the press so that we can get the most accurate view of history while also not disrupting history? Thank you.
I just wanted to say, I'm not gonna answer your question, but I do want to throw in that the Supreme Court has been very clear before the internet that citizens have exactly the same rights, no more, no less, than the press to cover trials, and the press has exactly the same right as citizens, no more, no less, to cover trials. I don't agree with that decision, but that is the current law of the land, is my understanding.
So I will answer your question from my perspective. As a person that is considered a public figure, which I think does change the landscape, and obviously, I'm in a position also where many of our proceedings are subject to media requests. I would say for my smaller citizen journalists, my advice would be to make sure that, A, you follow the rules, right? So for me, I always say we have a director of communications in my office. She's actually sitting in the back, Claire Chapins. And so the first thing we say is, all of our traditional media knows if they are gonna be following Rule 22 or wanna follow what's happening in our office, you know, is there gonna be a press conference, what's happening? They know to follow the protocol and immediately reach out to the Director of Communications to understand what's happening in the proceedings and what access you may or not be given. I think where we run into issues sometimes with journalists sort of outside that traditional arena is, A, honestly, if you decide to like walk up on our attorneys in court and start asking them questions, or walk up to me in the hallway and say, hey, with your, you know, your phone camera, will you comment, things like that. So I would say the most important thing from my perspective is that we would just like and hope and insist that our citizen journalists would just A, understand the rules and the dynamics of the jurisdiction for which you are operating in, and we ask you to make those same types of protocols that we would expect of all and the rest of our media counterparts follow. And we do that by placing everything on our website. Anybody can go to our website and see who the media contact is, ask to join our release, and get that information. But following those rules and that protocol is really important, and it goes a really long way.
Any other answers to that? Dale?
I would concur. I think it's very important to do exactly what Sherry is saying. And the independent journalists that you're talking about, we didn't have Substacks 20 years ago, but they now exist. There's a proliferation of them. Some of them are very good, some of them I follow. But you have to make sure that you follow the laws and the rules that everyone else has to live by. You guys are making, I know a bunch of you here remember Jack Jurcevich? Am I pronouncing it right? You remember him?
Yeah.
He made law in the state of Georgia. He was an independent journalist back in the day, 30, 40 years ago. He would do things that none of the rest of us would do, and often it would end up in some sort of court battle, and often he won, not always, but often. So there's an important role you play to be that independent journalist. It's a different set of eyes. You're operating under, in many ways, a different game than we are, but you got to follow the rules. If there's no cameras in the hallway, you pull out your cell phone, you may be outside the courthouse and may not be back in, because judges don't like that when you don't follow their rules. So you've got to educate yourself, as Sherry was saying. And I would, you guys are used to it now.
Yeah, right? And I would say, you know, shout out to my friend George Chidi. Everybody knows who George is now, but I remember back in 2010, 2011, when George was really just working as an independent journalist and doing stories for blogs in and around DeKalb on courthouse issues. And I remember him like reaching out to my office to ask for comments on things when I was solicitor. And of course now we see him at the center of things and on CNN and working for The Guardian and other things. So it's natural, I think, a lot of our smaller independent journalists that are like embedded in our communities, you know, have information or access, but they understand that they have to comport themselves in a way that's in line with, you know, their much bigger traditional counterparts.
One thing to remember too for journalists is the court's not there to try the case for the media. So given what our talk's about, the circus. So I took over for a judge, Perry Brand, who had done it for 30 years. And he was a man of few words. But one of the things he told me coming on was this saying probably many have heard, you know, don't let the sideshow take over the circus, okay? So what happens in the court is there is, in these big high profile cases, there's a big media push and everybody wants to get in. If everyone is at least attempting to comply with the rules, Rule 22 and the other things that address how we get cameras into the courtroom and Superior Court, then what we're able to do as the court is funnel that into a plan where we can figure out pooling, we can figure out access, we can do whatever we need to do to make sure everybody is able to get the information they need. But if folks aren't complying with those rules, if folks just think they can walk into the courthouse and pull their phone out and start videotaping the proceedings, then it becomes much more difficult for the court to do its core job, which is to try the case. So that's why those rules are in place, and that's why we talk about them here. So the best thing to do, again, and you just heard it from three different people, is find out what the rules are that apply in that courtroom. Each judge treats Rule 22 a little bit differently.
But once you start getting into higher profile matters, it starts getting quite streamlined because the courts don't want to deal with it day to day. Right? We put some rules in place and figure out how to coordinate.
I just want to say, though, I follow the rules in life in general, but remember, you have exactly the same right as CNA to be there. And I don't know if all judges and all institutions understand that. There is no difference. The Supreme Court has said there's no difference between your right to be there and cover and CBS's right to be there. And so you should not accept second class status because you're not CNA. That's my advice.
Thank you, guys. I see a question in the corner. Frank, you're going to have to double time.
Andrew steps in today.
He's going to meet you in the middle. That's good.
Good morning. Thank you so much to the panel. This has been great to be able to hear all the insight. I'm Julia Janae. I'm a member of the bar here in Georgia, also an anchor for Court TV. So cameras in the courtroom is what we do all the time. Had the privilege of being in Judge Walmsley's courtroom for the Ahmaud Arbery case, the trial. That could have been a case study for courtrooms working with the media in a really awesome way. My question is about some high-profile trials where judges have chosen to not allow live stream or live tweeting. They've more so leaned to allowing it to happen after, saying that you can release it to the public after it's over or delaying it an hour. The Ahmaud Arbery trial was live streamed. So Judge Walmsley, if you can speak to this or any other member of the panel who may have insight, what's the reasoning for that? What do you think some judges are reluctant to allow that live coverage? And do you have any recommendations for them for that issue?
You're aware of how I did it. No, I don't really have any insight on what the thought would be there. I mean, it is, there's some reticence out there with the messaging going out, how it might impact what's going on in the courtroom. Putting some delay on it gives the court a little bit more authority on what might get out there just in case something may happen in the courtroom. I mean, there's a lot of probably different reasons that people think these things through and put those rules in place for. As you said, that just wasn't my position. My position early on was to try to work as close. I mean, there's a huge media pool. And I think ultimately, Court TV took over for some of the local stations that were trying to do the feed. And I guess this goes to show that it can happen. There was a good relationship, good working relationship. And when I say working relationship, it's not the court's role to provide information directly. We didn't do any of that. But what we did is we coordinated the logistics and made sure that there was there's a single point of contact for media. We had I think pretty robust live streaming capability, and we did the whole setup knowing that it was going to be a project. But as to how other judges do it, I just don't know. The way I did it seemed to work under those circumstances. Different judges have to deal with different courtrooms, different sheriffs, different security issues, different media pools. So I just can't speak to what they would be doing.
Can I ask? Our audience members who do this for a living, has anyone challenged that legally, to your knowledge, on the cameras in the courtroom issue, but the live streaming or live TV?
I'll address that. I'll come to the mic.
And Tom, this is going to give you the last word.
Very good. I'm Tom Clyde. I'm a partner at Kilpatrick Townsend and represented some of the media organizations in the Arbery case. And want to compliment Judge Walmsley on what I thought was a beautifully handled case from beginning to end. One of the things that he is not mentioning was handled in a historic courthouse that he does not typically appear in. He was visiting and serving the state in that role. And it worked extremely well, as I think Julie explained. And that's a lot of credit to the organization that he delivered on a daily basis. But I do agree that there are occasionally challenges to live streaming, and I do think that is driven by judges' reluctance to not have some control if information comes out in the courthouse, in the courtroom, that they then don't want to be disclosed. I think that's a significant mistake. I think one of the things that really made the Arbery case very effective from a not just from national perspective, but locally, is the community could watch exactly what was happening. They could see that this was being taken extremely seriously. They could see the process of justice working out. So I think for the nation and for that community, there was a healing process that resulted from that trial. And I think the more filters you put, to use Dale's words, the more filters you put, including a delay, really disrupt that healing process. And so I don't think delays work. I think streaming does work. I think really the COVID environment has proven that because things were being streamed regularly. So I think the reflex to try and impose limits on streaming is really a bad idea, and I'm glad it didn't occur in the Arbery case.
Thank you, Tom, and panel, thank you so much for giving us your time and your insights. This has really been a lot of fun, and I think extremely helpful for everybody. Thank you.
The next session will start at the bottom of the hour on rethinking campaign coverage. That's at the bottom of the hour. So you've got about 14 minutes for a comfort break. We'll start sharp at the bottom of the hour.
A delightful day.
Oh, anytime you're doing this, you are in.
Thank you for that, because in the past I've always been.
Well, but it saves us and it makes a permanent record.
Yeah, it was. Did you know what you said? It was one of the discussions you had.